has nothing to do with how do you, I mean, all of patents and all of that stuff, but it has to do with my experiences over the last 6 years where we've submitted about 75 ideas into three companies. I have seen about 20 people submit IP. They're all agile teams varying from Scrum sprint sizes of 1 week to 4 weeks. The people with 3 years experience to 15. Personally, I hold about 2 granted patents. I have 2 patents pending. I have 7 defenses. So we're talking about a lot of it. But this is not about all of that. The philosophy is, how many of you would want to have some sort of IP in your name in your lifetime? About 70% raise their hands and 30% don't believe they will have one, but they can. So that smile say that because that is exactly the first reaction which I get. But that's the reason I put up these pictures. The reason being that most of us tend to think that IP is about software code and some magic moment where you will invent a light bulb. These are actual patents. I hold the one in the middle, the one there, and this is patent pending. And this one probably saved our jobs for at least 10 or 15 people for 3 years. So really, what I'm trying to tell you is that this saved jobs and lives because somebody came up with an idea when a VP put his leg up on a table and he said in 6 months he would shut us down if we didn't change the way we did things. The next one was when I was testing my phone, testing the product as part of one of the testing user stories which we were doing. That is actually the Sony World signal in Kormangla. If you've ever gone to Kormangla, it's that really crowded signal where you find it very difficult. It stops a lot, and then there's that period between it. I used to work at Yahoo at that time. So you have the period from the Sony World signal to that army base where the phone signal keeps dropping. And as I used to keep testing it on my way to office, that is when I came up with the idea. And that's actually a granted patent on 31st December of this year. The next one is called serendipity because have you traveled to US? Several of you, right? When you get into those hotels, you see those sheaves of newspapers which are kept in the entry. Does it get fatter or thinner on Sundays? Fatter. How fat? About this fat? 40, 50 papers. So yeah, this one we filed about 18 months back when my team was building certain APIs. And I call it serendipity because it just happened that we got an idea based on those newspapers and the APIs we were building and stuff like that. So in 2 months, you should be able to see it public, but this is under patent pending. The last one is when I used to build, so I used to work in telecom about many years back, and this one got granted some time back. So do you have parents who live alone? Do you have someone in your family who lives alone? Often there is this case when they live alone, you try to call them and they don't pick up the phone. And you're scared whether they've fallen down or they're sick or whatever. So there's a patent called forced answer communications. You can go look it up. I own that patent, but the story. But why am I talking about all this? Not because I'm some great inventor or something, but because often in agile sprints, these were all agile teams. In agile sprints, we were building an API, we were building a mobile site, we were testing our stuff, and this one, we were building a telecom product. The best way to actually find IP is not necessarily in the user story, but what I call as the story behind the story. So what I want you to take away from this slide really is most people tend to think, oh, I can never file an IP because God knows, I don't know that algorithm which needs to be done. But the start is not the algorithm. The start is actually the problem. So each of you have problems that you face in your work life, in your personal life, in whatever. So the takeaway I want you to take from this, which I tell everybody who I talk to, is all of us are capable of identifying a problem which nobody has solved before. Or if somebody solved it, well, find the solution for it. But that's the takeaway I'd like you to take from this slide. Now, what do you do once you've found the problem? You need to protect. Most of it is, I found, is people say they cannot do it because they don't know how to protect it. There is obviously going to be a legal team, but you need to know a little bit about how to protect. So a couple of minutes on that. What are those?
Logos.
Usually, how would you protect them? All the answers are correct, but trademark is the correct answer. It is your trademark. You are McDonald's because you see that M. What is that? The answer already came. You just need to pick one. It's a movie. It's theory of everything. It's a copyright. So the reason I kept keeping all this is because I don't know what industries you're from. If you're not from IT, you might actually be able to copyright stuff. I know a person who is in IT. His name, so you've heard this. Three Idiots, have you heard this song called Behti Hawasa, the song that starts? There's a guy called Swanand Kirkire who wrote that song. He was an engineer who used to work on the telecom product that I used to work with. So you never know, you might actually copyright stuff. And that, obviously, you can probably tell what it is. It's a patent. It's Apple's thing. And what is that? The formula of Coke, what is it? It's a trade secret. So quickly, trademarks, you know that. Copyrights, that. Patents, you don't have, I'm not a legal expert, but there's things like utility, design, plant patents, and all of that stuff. Trade secrets, Coca-Cola. Another place, now, because you're talking of protection, I don't know if you're from companies which outsource stuff or even do stuff. So there's another place, places in non-disclosure agreements that you could use. Employment agreements, all of us have confidentiality clauses. Work contracts, we all have them. Technology transfer, if you're coming in from a company where you need to take technology, it happens between countries, outsourcing agreements. But so to tie in the story, you don't have to search for patents always in code. It could be in the problems that you have. Once you've found the problem, these are some of the means that you could do. But why are we showing you this slide? Because in the wonders of Agile and Sprint and all of this stuff, we tend to forget that there is IP we're building every day. So this is the how part of what would you do. And there'll be legal people who'll help you do it, but you need to know it because you're the ones who are creating the idea. But why? A couple of reasons why you should do it, because often if you know the why, you'll know whether your company will support you or not. You want to secure an investment. How many of you from a startup? So obviously, I don't know how many ideas your startup runs on, but several startups are one idea startups. So it's one idea, that's it. If you do not secure that and somebody takes up that idea, you lose your market completely. People culture, I'll give you some examples of how we have been able to actually improve, reduce attrition in teams by simply having this IP as a means of culture as part of your teams. Pre-acquisition and pre-IPO. This is business stuff, really heavy. So go and look up videos of what happened when Facebook started, when Facebook was about to go IPO. Go and look up the recent videos about Alibaba. You all heard of Alibaba? It's the biggest IPO that recently happened. It's huge. It started acquiring patents from IBM. It started acquiring from all sorts of companies in order to protect itself. Pre-acquisition. So there's this. So I used to work for this company called Novell. It got acquired by a PE firm. And you've heard of Motorola Mobility. It got acquired by Google, right? So you can go and look up an article in the internet which says that the price for which these two companies were bought divided by the number of patents that they held was actually the same number. So often acquisition can depend on the worth that you have. So remember that, so think from that. If you've got what you're doing could potentially impact your company significantly. And if you're in a startup and own stock of that, it could mean a lot more. Method of future income, quite obvious. Single idea startups, protect your market share. Tool to gain confidence. Publish and make an available idea to the public. This kind of seems very converse, but it does happen. Now, why does all this matter in the context of Agile? Because one of the things that I've always found is that people tend to think of these really interesting myths. How many of you are architects? One. So you're the only one who should be filing patents in this room, or is capable, to be honest. Rest of us are not. How many of you are managers? 40%. None of you are capable of filing any patents. So managers, what do? You're the people manager. Right? You fill timesheets, right? You basically, timesheets come to you, you approve it, and you have to approve leaves, right? That's kind of your job. People don't come to the office. You tell people you have to come at 9, go back at 5. Maybe you give out salary letters, maybe not. But that's the other one. How many of you are over 10 years of industry experience? Okay, so I think you're the only ones who can probably file stuff. I mean, the rest of us probably are too young, right? I mean, you all have known more than 10 years. You are the leads, you are the this ones. So these are myths I've often heard very, very commonly across Scrum teams, which are based on only my Scrum lead can do it, only my architect can do it. My product owner is the only one who knows the market. I don't know the market. I am supposed to code. These are actual people whom I've worked with over the last 6 years, who are a variety of people. They are actually a representation of this room. You can look them up. This guy is currently a startup founder in Delhi. He was a technical lead when he used to work with me. He went up. So what I'm telling you is that he found something, went on, started doing something totally different. That guy's a tech lead. That is a guy who saved our jobs for 3 years. So he actually is that. That guy's an engineering manager. He's a manager. So he does all the leave approval stuff that 40% of this room does. Okay, but he also does that. Because I honestly don't believe that, I mean, each of you were at some point either an engineer or something that you were good at, and you're probably still good at it. Just because you approve leaves doesn't mean you don't know how to code. I mean, you can. And just because you know how to code doesn't mean that you can file a patent. It could be the other way around. That guy's an architect, of course. That lady had about 3 years of industry experience. Typically, we tend to look at them as 3 years. Come on, I'm telling you what to do. Again, an architect. So effectively, what I'm trying to tell you is that I've worked with over 20 people who submitted stuff. I have people, at least 8 to 10 people who have approvals. We've submitted 75 ideas. And there is cross section of people. So the reason that I'm telling you all of this is to walk away with the belief that you can do it too. But how? Here are some of the best practices we did, and you could take it back to your sprint Scrum teams. So if you're how many Scrum Masters and product owners? Okay, that's about 40-50% of the room. Have you ever done anything to promote IP? Never. Okay, so I'm hoping there's some learnings you can take back from here. Have an IP checkpoint in your sprint review checklist. How many of you have that? None. So you have one. How does it help? Sorry? You have a review checklist, but do you have IP in that? No. So it's a good opportunity to think about it. You're not actually telling people to file IP. You're just telling people think about it. That's all you're telling the people. Talk about new ideas within stand-up. So when somebody comes up with a new idea, how many times do you actually think and tell them, hey, can you look it up if somebody else has never done it? That could save your jobs for the next 3 years. Encourage collaborative IP creation, very, very important. We often tend to think of it, this is my idea, I am the best one who knows it. The best teams which have come up with IP I found is when you have more than one person coming together with complementary skill sets. Somebody knows the design, somebody knows the technology, somebody knows how to implement it, somebody knows the algorithm. And it has to naturally happen. You may not be able to force it. But when you see two or three people coming together, encourage them to come together. So that's what I call as collaborative IP. Encourage it from the sprint work, obviously. So when you have stories, you have checkpoints, you're always looking at it, and experiential, which means that depending on the type of company you are, you might be also a user of your product. So have that view. So something for you to take back. People managers, I think I'm assuming about 30 to 40% of you are also people managers. How many of you have goals or even have a conversation or give credit for people who've thought about something new or IP? Okay, two people out of about 20 or at least 15 managers. It is an exceptional retention tool. Now I'll tell you a trick. When you actually find an IP, when you submit an IP, a company typically takes 2 months to look at it. 2 months, the person is not going to leave your team or company. After that, it potentially gets reviewed and approved. That can take, depending on the company, anywhere between 2 to 3 months. If it gets approved, there is a hype and a high factor, which that person gets. Once that happens, he's going to stay for a few more months. Once it gets approved, there's money you get at filing, money at approval, and all of this stuff. You basically retain the guy for 1.5 years. And by doing that, it's an amazing boost to your team and people. So think about it. Have a reward system. Most of your companies should have it in some way. Make tools accessible. IP as a retention tools. Discuss it in your one-on-ones. That's probably your takeaway. Senior management, if any of you are, say, directors above, so on and so forth, ensure budgets, because there's no use of peeping up with wonderful ideas with no budget to approve them. That's kind of useless. If you have all hands, talk about it. Scrum team members, I'm assuming a lot of you are team members, right? At least the remaining, I would assume, who are not managers. Identify similar-minded people, brainstorm. Don't be afraid to share, though not outside the company, so you wouldn't come to a forum like this and share your ideas. It's okay to fail. The most amazing thing I've found is people tend to think that it's, oh, I'm going to fail. Yes, you're going to fail. You're going to fail 9 times out of 10. That is USPTO numbers. Only 40 to 45% of ideas, of filed ideas from a company actually get approved. Within companies, the rates could be anywhere between 10% to 25% or lower. So it's okay, you're going to fail. But then as long as your people managers support you, you have that support system in place, you're going to be just fine. When somebody submits something, remember to congratulate. So that's more or less it. So to summarize, look for the story behind the story. That's where you detect IP. I told you how do you protect it. Within your sprints and scrums, make sure that you look for patents, trademarks, IP. Look at the myth that each one of you in this room is capable of filing. So I've given you examples of managers, non-managers, everybody. Celebrate it. Look for the best practices, whether you're a people manager, whether you're a scrum leader, whether you're a product manager, whether you're a scrum master. You've all have some takeaways to take from here. And finally, it's okay to fail, so you'll do that. So eventually, it's something to tell yourself that at best, you will become an inventor. At least, you're going to learn. So that's really the crux of everything that we have. Thank you. I can take a few questions.
With an amazing idea, a sellable idea, and of it all you get is like, let's say, get a 10K as cash prize and a company. So how does it help an individual as such? Because company is going to own the idea, company will be responsible.
Second is, when if all things are equal on a promotion committee when you're sitting, you might get a promotion ahead of somebody else. Third, obviously your company owns the idea. In fact, there are different companies which say whether the company should own or the individual should own. Yes, that's something we do as part of our NDA clause. Fourth is, when you put it on your LinkedIn profile and I come to interview you, if all things are equal, you might actually be able to impress me by talking about it. So it really is your career. The fifth is very altruistic. It is that if you are an engineer and you believe in creating things and you feel happy about being rewarded through an IP, that's what it is. And of course, the sixth is money. You get a lot of money. So there are companies which could give you anywhere up to $8,000 to $10,000 per filing. To answer your question?
Yeah.
Anything else?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Enjoy your lunch.